So welcome everybody. So let me introduce you to Shashi a bit, though she really doesn't need an introduction to most of you. Shashi and I, we go back quite a long time. I first met her through her mother-in-law, Ambujam, who came to the Krishnamurti school for admitting Raghu's sister. And then we have met Raghu and Shashi because Ambujam insisted that I should meet them and that we'd become friends. And that's what happened. Then I met, of course, Raghu's other sister, Mala, and all knew them separately, and Suresh. So the whole family is their friends for some time. Shashi, seeing her through her journey, I think has been quite a remarkable one for her and for many others who she has taken on this journey with her. After finishing her architecture in the School of Architecture in Madras University, she worked and she was practicing architecture. And I think meeting Dharampal kind of influenced her and Raghu and others to take up some Indian study, and she took up architecture and studied with Ganpati Shastri, who's a traditional temple architect in Mahabalipuram, and she spent many years with him, working, studying, and understanding the principles of traditional architecture, and has now become the authority in Vastu Shastras. Together with Ganpati Sapati and Bala, Raghu and Shashi made a film, which was an award-winning film on Ganpati Sapati, on the temple architecture. The film, you may look it up, I think was called
The Shilpi
The
Speaks.
Shilpi Speaks. Yeah. So that film is a beautiful film, and it's worth watching many times over. And after that, Shashi has written many books, and we can put that up. If it's not on her PowerPoint, we'll put it up in the chat, and you can follow it through after her talk. So welcome, Shashi. Yes.
I don't have it on my PowerPoint.
We'll put it up. Yeah.
Okay. Otherwise, I have it next to me. I can.
No, we'll put it up. We have
Okay.
the things.
Great. Great.
So with Schoolscape also, we have and in my work with teachers involved Shashi quite a lot, working with teachers, helping them to reflect, because we feel that especially for a teacher, the personhood of the teacher is so important that it comes into play every minute, how you react, how you respond to children, you know, when children say, how do you converse with them. So that personhood is important, and Shashi has helped many of our teachers and trainers also work with themselves and look at themselves from their inner self and also from the outer to the inner. So welcome, Shashi, and enjoy always working with you and learning anew. So
Thank you,
what you
Amo.
do, yeah.
I'm always thrilled to work with Amo and meet so many teachers who are in their own rights, change agents of so many young people. And most of the people whom I have met through Amo, whether it's the Montessori stream or any other stream, they are people who are committed to children. And that's something that always makes me feel good. And I know that it's a very difficult subject, and I think we have about 2 hours, out of which I don't like to talk for too long because it becomes a little too much of data. So what I'll do is I have prepared some PowerPoints because it's a visual subject. That's the only reason, no? So don't go off to sleep, because PowerPoints usually put people to sleep. But the reason is that unless you see the form, it's very difficult to envisage. Some of us are born with that, the capacity to create forms in the mind. Most others are not. So it's an unfair demand, expecting you to understand what I'm saying without giving you some reference with visuals. Okay. So I'm going to do two things today, because Amu has talked about how most of you are teachers. Some of you may be otherwise, but most of you are teachers. So how do I bring alive the traditions of India to my children? That becomes a big sort of a burden, because the reading material that is available is usually Eurocentric in vision. So almost everything that you will read about the history of India or the Vedas written by Max Müller or whatever, as Dharampal would say, is Eurocentric, which means that it has always tried to keep it as secondary to the Greek civilization. That was their intention, all authorship that comes from the European world. That Greece is the foremost and everything else comes later. In fact, when we were traveling in Rome, both of us were quite shocked with the person who was the tour guide telling us 90% of world art is in Italy. So we said, what happens to the remaining rest of the world here? What are you people talking about? So this attitude has to be re-looked at. And the only way we can re-look at it is bringing about fairly dependable and well put together data sheets that talk to you about a living tradition. And I think that is terribly important. Almost all other traditions in the world have died because of colonialism. They have been wiped out. In India, somehow it has survived. But once again, there's an onslaught going on. I believe it's the second or third colonization that's going on. Constant anti-Hindu stuff going on all the time. But we have to survive this too. And the only way we can survive this too is by holding the integrity of what we know, rather than getting into empty sort of, dialogues and empty pride and so on. We have to actually be able to show what we know, right? And for that, we have to do a lot of research. We have to listen to a lot of people. And I had the singular good knowledge, the good experience of being with knowledgeable people like Ganapati Sthapathi, who was able to teach me quite authentically. Because main thing is that we didn't get into English at all. Almost all the learning was in Tamil. And with a smattering of Sanskritam, because he also knew his Sanskritam quite well. So I believe that that kind of authentic learning is the basis, which is what Dharampal actually pushed us into, what Amukta was mentioning. There were about 20 of us, more or less about the same age, between 25 and 35. And all of us, university educated, many technologists and so on. And he challenged us. He said, the only way this tradition, which is a marvelous tradition, will move into the next century is if educated people like you take it up as your personal mission. And you study it with an authentic teacher for a long period of time. In fact, he said 10 years. So I went with Ganapati Sthapathi for 10 years. Raghu went with Krishnamacharya for 10 years. So for 10 years, you study with them. Honor their learning. Go to them like seekers. Right? Sit with them, study with them, work with them. Which is precisely what we did. And then he said, bring it back into the mainstream. Don't just learn it, which happens to a lot of intellectuals. They study for themselves. Write some notes and put it into their library and sit tight. So he said, you have to bring it back, anchor it back in the marketplace. And that, I think, is a remarkable lesson that we learned with him. So from when I was 32, when I started studying with Ganapati Sthapathi, to now when I'm going to be 72, it's a long journey where I have studied, I have written, I have taught, and I have also designed. So it's a fairly comprehensive process. Now going back into education in a big way, we're going to be doing a master's course on Vastu Shastra, which is the first time in university education. We're going to be starting in September in a School of Architecture in Pune. And I think it's a marvelous new journey for us. I only wish I was 10 years younger, but that's okay. There are many others who have learned with me. So for you teachers, the reason why I'm giving this preamble is for you teachers, for this traditional wisdom and knowledge to become part of your life is very important. Not just as data, not just as information that you're just sort of giving out in a classroom. It cannot be like that. Because the most important part of parampara siksha, you must remember parampara siksha or education is very different from what you're learning today. Closest maybe a Montessori kind of system, but this is even deeper than that. Because here you're saying information becomes knowledge, becomes embodied. So your body has to retain this knowledge so that it lives with you and then you transfer it to another child. Okay. So parampara siksha is a very critical element in what I have learned and what I am transferring. So today as teachers, this methodology of parampara siksha, where the child and all the art traditions had parampara siksha. And you, whether you take dance or music or vastu or craft, there is a theoretical base. It is not, in a vacuum. There's a tremendously powerful theoretical base. But the theory is not pushed onto the child too early. First, the senses are opened out. And that is the most important factor. Because then the learning becomes a comprehensive learning, holistic learning. And the most important sense that is opened out is the hands. And as we all know today, the sensitivity of the hands, whether you're doing healing work, whether you're doing artwork, whatever you're doing, whether you're cooking, the hands have something to say. And this was very critical to all the parampara siksha. Okay. So when I went to Ganapati Stapati, he told me, you have to learn sculpture. So I started sculpting. I used to go twice a week, 6 to 8 hours. I would sit in the yard with the boys and I would sculpt, but I could only sculpt with soapstone because my body was not strong enough to work with granite. But that was a beautiful experience. The ability to scale down an amorphous piece of stone into something that is beautiful is a remarkable process. Then he told me, you have to learn to dance. So I said, oops, I have never danced. I have done a little bit of music. I'm a yoga practitioner. But dance? No, 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 no. He said, no, because Shilpa Shastra, it is called Vastu Shilpa Shastra. Vastu signifies building, the built form, and Shilpa is the sculpted form. So he said, to understand sculpture, you have to learn to use your body. So at the age of 32, I went to a teacher and started learning dance. And in dance, in the whole Shilpa Shastra, which is later one of the people whom I have worked with, Jyotsna has come in, I know. You're there, Jyotsna? I thought I saw
you. Yes, Sashi, very much.
Yeah. Okay. So, Jyotsna knows what I'm talking about because I worked with her in Kalakshetra with her students. There is a theory called Kaya Madhya Sutram in Shilpa Shastra, which speaks about the energy axis that runs from the middle of the top of your head all through the center of your body and falls at on the ground between your 2 feet when you're standing erect. which is called Samapada Sthanakam. So when you're standing in that posture, there is this energy axis that falls through your body and touches the floor. So it connects Bhumi and Akasha. This thread in a sculpture is called Kaya Madhya Sutram. It is the same thread that is called Shruti in music. So when you sing in any of the classical traditions of India, the alignment of Shruti is this alignment of this Kaya Madhya Sutram. In the spiritual systems, this is called Sushumna Nadi, which is the energy that runs through your body. It is an unseen energy. It is not physically available. It is there. It's just an energy line. So that basically, the process of yoga is to bring inwardly all your energies so that it becomes dense and strong in the center of your body. And when it becomes luminous, that is when it's called Sushumna. So all this, you know, the granthis have to be removed, your chakras have to be opened. There are many schools, but essentially it has something to do with your physical body. Which is why, if you look at Tirumandiram, it says Ullam Perungoil Oon Udambu Alayam. So the mind is the inner temple, but the body is its structure. So you have to nurture, honor, look after your body. And the moment you look after the body in an aesthetic manner, which means through gnans, you have created a different pathway to understand your own consciousness. So Vastu Shastra, essentially, after having said all that, now I'll try to pull it all together. Vastu Shastra is really talking about the inner space, which is your own consciousness, your senses, your mind, your apparatus, thinking apparatus, your feeling apparatus, your body, and the physical space the body occupies. Okay? Then there is another subset. Not even subset, it is the main set. My body, the physical space, and a cosmic space. So Vastu Shastra says, when the cosmic energy, your inner yearning and your inner desire and the physical space you occupy, when they are in alignment, it is said that you have Brahmanandam. You have this extraordinary experience. Okay? So our temples are built with this in mind. When the individual, the bhakta, walks into the temple, the physical space, the universal space and the inner space of the individual come together to create a complete alignment. That was what the temple was designed for. It was not for group prayer. Group prayer is just a small aspect of it. It is for the individual seeking. Okay? So we'll talk about it a little more. So is this more or less clear to everybody? Can I have some thumbs up, something? Am I making sense? Yeah, great. Okay. Then we will move to the first slide. So first, honor the ancestors who have given us this wisdom, the great people who have been with us, on whose shoulders we are standing today. I honor the ancestor. Okay? Let's start.
One second, I'm sharing.
The first slide, yeah. That's right. Okay. So, I already explained to you a little bit about Parampara Siksha. And on the picture, you have Nartana Ganapati, the dancing Ganesha. which is one of the most beautiful forms, with that ungainly, disproportionate body. Look at the elegance of his movement. Okay. So the skill building has to be done. Right? Drawing, sculpting, construction of buildings, understanding materials. And then in the evenings, with the light of the lantern, they would study the texts. Not only the Vastu texts, but Veda and the Vedanga. So simultaneously, every part of you is appreciating the aesthetic sensibility, which means rasanubhava. Okay. Next one. So this is something that I try to explain to a lot of people. Our university education is constantly stressing on the rational mind. I put A and B and put them together, and then I create a visible commodity or a visible object that I can measure. Okay. So it's linear logic. It's completely with the mind, something that is tangible. And then everything that I see in the world is correct. What cannot be seen, what is invisible, what is intangible, is either a lie or it does not exist. So ambiguity is completely put aside. Okay. But the mystical mind, the mind that is capable of looking at reality in many layers, looks at things in a cyclical manner. Even as I start something, even if I end something, something else has started, something has died, and something is being born. So this ability to see the continuous cyclic nature of reality is a part of the mystical mind. Next one. Yeah. And then, of course, like I told you, the Eurocentric reality. All science and technology comes from Europe. Everything else is blind faith, retarded, backward, everything else. Okay. So the fact that there was a scientific underpinning to every society is completely ignored. But then they quickly scramble around and steal whatever does not belong to them and call it their own. This has been going on for centuries. Those of you who don't know, and perhaps you need to read Dharampal. If you haven't read, please read him. The whole idea of the vaccine, the smallpox vaccine, was already being practiced in India. When there was an epidemic, people in the white town died like rats. Black town were fine. So they checked it out and they found out that they were using a barbaric practice of inoculating the disease into the body of the patients. And they seem to have survived. So there's a huge paper on this. This data is taken to England and the vaccine is developed. No acknowledgement of the root. Okay. So the fact is, ambiguity is important. Parameters are important. Having a test case is important. Repeatability is important. But there are things that cannot be repeated. Knowing that is also important. So how do you, as an individual, as a teacher, as a person who's inhabiting the world today, how do you blend these two? Because we need both. Because if you keep on doing only the mystical mind, and there is no physical experience of it, then you could very easily get into what is known as misapprehension. You could be fooling yourself. You could get into fantasy. So there is a need to bring the two together. Next one. Right. So one of the first things I learned, which is, I think, essential to the work that I've been doing, and I think important for every one of you, There are three very critical systems of Vijnana: yoga, Ayurveda, and Vastu. Yoga I'm putting on the crest because it is what straddles all three. It is the basis for everything. And yoga doesn't mean asana pranayama alone, please. That is a complete misunderstanding by people. It's not, doesn't mean that you have to do your asanas correctly. Yoga is a pathway. It means the ability to bring to alignment various parts of yourself through various paths. Okay? And each of the path has a meaning. Vastu is the ability to create spaces and forms that are in balance. Ayurveda is the method through which your body with its multiple streams is in balance. And it's not one permanent state of balance. It's constantly moving during times of the day, during seasons, and different age factors. So when I'm 16 to when I'm 40 to when I'm 70, what is the diet? What is it doing to me? What is food? Okay. All this becomes very, very important for us to look at for creating balance and harmony. Next one. Yeah. One of the most critical principles of Vastu Shastra comes from Mahabharata. It is said that when Arjuna was standing on the edge of the forest, which they have started to burn, there is this man who comes running out of the forest and says, I am Maya, the Shilpi of the Danavas. And please save me and I will be able to help you. And it's very interesting because literally we are straddling through two itihasas. He is the father of Mandodari in the Ramayana. And because he's a Danava, he's also immortal. So he is still alive during the Mahabharata era. He comes and says, in return for having been saved, I will design for you this extraordinary city, Indraprastha, where it is called the Maya Sabha, a building filled with illusions, with aesthetics and so on. And he says, there are three important aspects of Vastu Shastra, and I am an expert because I have built the city of Lanka. The three aspects are Bhogadhyam. Bhogadhyam means the form, the function, the use, utilitarian aspects of the building. Sukha Darshanam, which means aesthetics. Then Ramya. Ramya means inner delight. Not only must it be aesthetically pleasing to my senses, but within me, to that inner being or my consciousness, there must be a sense of delight and a sense of peace. Okay, so this is the basis of Vastu Shastra, and I think it stands its test of time because it's still one of the most important aspects of any design. Next one. Right. Then this is a famous Vastu Purusha Mandala, which everybody probably has seen sometime or the other and been scared by practitioners into saying you're in the wrong position and so on. Actually, the Vastu Purusha Mandala is a physical morphed version of just energy. Just as everything else in Sanatana Dharma, it is made into a story and it is created, made into a form so that it will stay in your mind and it will make sense to you. The story is that it was an asura who was completely out of control in Devaloka. And then the devas get very worried about how to handle this fellow. So Brahma says, throw him onto the earth and sit on his back. So the story goes on to say, Vastu Purusha was thrown onto the earth with his face down and 45 devatas sat on his back with Brahma in the center. And so this Vastu Purusha literally means enormous potent energy, which is what an asura is. But it is also capable of being extremely positive and vibrant. So you have to make him auspicious because he's on his face. When he is auspicious and turned over and lying down, face upward, at certain times of the year, he is considered to be full of positive power. Those are the times when the Vastu is awake, Vastu Purusha. Those are the times when you do the puja and start your house activity. It will be written in the Panchangam, these days, these months, and so on. So Vastu Purusha wakes up early in the morning, he gets up, he eats, then finally he has his Tambulam, and that's when he is at his best. So the calculation will be for about 2.5 to 3 hours. At the end of it, when he has had his Tambulam, is when you do your pujas. Next one. Then there's something called Thala. How do you create a certain aesthetic proportion as well as inner delight is by using rhythms and proportions. So Thala in music, as you all know, is the beat, tempo. In sculpture, Thala is the visual tempo or the visual unit that is being used repetitively, either in the same size or in fractions that are rhythmic reductions. Okay, next one. Right. So there are many talas, out of which we'll go through the simple examples. The first three, Eka Tala, is the egg form, which has no face or anything like that. It's just an egg. Then the second one is part animal, part human. So that is considered to be Matsya Avatara, the proportion of the Matsya Avatara of Vishnu. Then the third one are the winged creatures, Kinnara. They are also partly human and partly bird or animal. Next one. Yeah. Then you have, oh, four has been missed. Just check if the next one is four. I think she has put it. No, after the, yeah, I think that's been, no, I think four has been missed. Doesn't matter. So you just go back to Panchatala. Panchatala is where the face into five is the proportion of the body. So it's a short form. Usually, Skanda as a child, Krishna as a child are in this form. Bala Krishna, Bala Murugan. Okay. Vinayaka or Ganesha is also in Panchatala because he is a child, eternal child with the face of the elephant. So that is in Panchatala. Panchatala is one of the most beautiful because it is just moved from animal form into a child form. Next one. Shatala. Shatala is slightly taller. Invariably, it will be the people around the kings and queens. It will also be some of the devatas who are of the shorter stature. Shattala. Then it is Saptatala, where you will have people. This also can be some devatas. And these proportions are very typical of the Shilpa Shastra. Those big shoulders, those long arms. This is this comes from Samudrika Lakshanam, which is a text which talks about the proportions of the body. Ajanu Bahu, if you see the description of Sri Rama or Sri Krishna, it talks about those long arms. And please note that these long arms are very symbolic of warriors. Their ability to take the string, the bow, remove the sword, and so on. Next one. Ashtatala usually is the rishis. Then Ashta is also the proportion. In Tamil, we say Enjan Vodambu. which means eight part, is the body of the human being. So it's also used for the human forms. Then you have Ashtatala, then Navatala. Navatala is a lot more elongated. Invariably, the devatas and the gods also can be shown in Navatala. Finally, it's Dashatala. So Dashatala, not only the gods, but also the ones who have created religions. So Buddha and Mahavira are also crafted in the Dashatala, which means the face into 10 parts. So it's a very slender, elegant body proportion as compared to, if you remember, the 4 and the 5 and the 6 were actually very sort of shortened. Here it's very elongated. Okay, the next one. The Nataraja form is also Dashatala. And here we are coming into something slightly different. As you noted, the Kaya Madhya Sutram falls from the top of the head to the base of Nataraja's feet, where he's standing on that Apasmaran, which is Moyalagar, the wrong knowledge. He is holding wrong knowledge under his control, and it's falling on that. And the body has slightly shifted, and it's called Bhanga. So there are many versions of Bhanga. Abhanga, Atibhanga, and Samabhanga. Then there's a fourth version called the Abhasa Bhanga, where you have lifted one leg, which is very classic of the Nataraja forms, Adavallan. Okay. So this is a kind of a Bhanga, and it is the most beautifully balanced Bhanga, where every aspect of the form has been given an arithmetical location, as you can see. What is the distance between the central line and the foot that is up, the knee that is bent, the arm that is on the side, the arm that is in a dolahasta, everything has been beautifully captured into a graph, into an arithmetical graph. Okay, next one. Yeah, this is Dakshinamurti, one of the most beautiful sculptures, unfortunately put in a cage now. It used to be open till about 10 years ago. This is in Dharasuram near Kumbakonam. Beautiful piece. This is also 1:10, Dashatala. Okay. Then you have various other forms which are in Bhanga. Buddha, the form which is on the left, lower left, is standing erect. Though the one arm is bent, that is a Samapadasthanaka. And the Buddha on top, who is sitting, he is keeping the Dharma Chakra Mudra. It's a very important Mudra, where both hands are in Chin Mudra. One is turned inward and the other is turned outward. I believe it means that he is in touch with his own inner sensitivity or inner being, and he is offering the wisdom to others simultaneously. And it's the wheel that is constantly turning, Dharma Chakra. Okay. Next one. Okay, so I just want to give you a little bit about the Padavinyasa, which is also very important for you people to remember. Every aspect of the temple building is a rhythmically intertwined module. The basic proportion, the tala of the sculpture, which is the face length in the temple complex, the tala or the pada is the size of the sanctum. Garbhagriha, the inner dimensions of the Garbhagriha become the basic unit, and every aspect of the complex is laid out with multiples or fractions of it. And that is a remarkable achievement. It means that it is like a beautifully sung song. if you take a kirtane, a kriti of Tyagaraja, which will be in beautiful balance, or a piece done by Muthuswami Dikshitar, everything will be in proportion. The sound, the thala, the raga, the thought process that goes into it, the philosophical content, they're all placed in layers that are in balance. Similarly, they have created this balanced, integrated, rhythmic structure. And the whole intention is when I walk into that space is capable of evoking that similar a sense of balance, which is in synchronicity with that outer balance. So the outer rhythmic balance and my inner rhythmic balance take place because of the nature of the structure itself. Next one. And then, of course, the grand old ancestor, the Brihadeeshwara temple, which I believe took 25 years to build. Father, the son, and then the grandson also worked on it. And the name of the Stapati was Rajaraja Perunthachan. And there's no stone available there. So the stone has come from Tiruchi, near Tiruchi. And one of the stories is that it came by, they created a canal and brought it on by water. The other is that they actually brought it on wheeled vehicles. There is also an absurd theory floating around in the internet which says there was a 3 kilometer long ramp on which it was brought, and that ramp is supposed to be abutting the structure, which is impossible because this structure, as all the old structures are, is built without mortar. So which means it's standing by self-weight until the top stone is placed. So if something is standing by self-weight and it is not a stable structure and you push something against it, it will fall. So there is no way they could have abetted a 3 kilometer long road onto this, because it would have had to go to the height of 216 feet. Completely absurd theory. What they did was they created what is known as a Sara Kattu Suvar, which is a scaffolding wall made of mud, which is 3 times the size of the temple. And it went up with every layer. The center, which was the Garbhagriha, was filled with sand. So they were able to get a platform, work platform, which was fairly large, on which all these workmen were actually doing their tasks, which is very important. You need a place on which the work can be done. Okay. So the whole tradition is that once the temple is built, the scaffolding is removed as if the egg has been removed and the embryo, the chick has come out. So apparently when that happened, the entire community would stand there, sing and dance, because they finally saw the building. Otherwise they could not see it because it was covered. Okay. Next one. And Ellora. Again, Kailasanatha temple in Ellora. Again, lot of crazy videos floating around saying the extraterrestrials came and did it. Mainly because the European community cannot accept that in India they did something this extraordinary when there was no machinery to do something like this. Because you're talking about 100-foot rock outcrop and they have dug into it. What did they do with the waste? Where did it go? How come such symmetry when they are digging in? What was the source imagery? Was there a three-dimensional model created? All these are very, very important questions. Many people are asking these questions and nobody thinks of going and asking the craftspeople these questions. You only have theoreticians coming up with absurd theories. Anyway, the craftsmen are capable of doing it because of the parampara siksha. Because within them, the grammar, in Tamil, it's called ilakkanam. the Lakshana of that tradition is so deeply embedded, so deeply internalized, that they are able to create things of such extraordinary size and magnitude through their skills. And another very important thing about the Vishwakarma community, which must have been there with the Ayurvedic people also in the distant past, is their teamwork, their ability to work together to create a marvel like this. Okay, the next one. So I'll just show you a few of these. There were five communities in the Vishwakarma. They were called Panu, Maya, Twashta, Shilpi, and Vishwagnya. Next one. Manush, the blacksmith. Okay. They made all the implements of war as well as tools for agriculture. Next one. Maya are the carpenters. They created the wooden roofs. They were also the makers of ratha, or the chariots, furniture, as well as the moving vehicles, chapparam and so on. They were also apparently the shipbuilders. Next one. Bell metal. There is also another thing, Twashta is the source for tachan. But this is the classification that comes from the Vedic tradition. So bell metal, the all the craft items, the cooking utensils, all of that is the Twashta. Shilpi is the stone craftsman, the temple builder, who quarries the stone, takes it to the site, sizes it, and builds the temples. Next. Then the Vishwagnya, who are the jewelers, the goldsmiths. Swarnakaras, they are known in Sanskrit. So almost all over the country, we have had all five of them. Then we have the puja and the ritual, which is part of the Vastu Shilpa Shastra, because the nature of the temple defines the puja and the ritual that is carried out there. So you have the Agamic tradition, then you have the Vedic tradition. Then in Vaishnava, you have Sampradaya, you have the Pancharatra, and then you have the Vaikhanasa. Each of them defines a particular methodology of puja, the kind of mantras that are chanted, the way in which the Garbhagriha is assembled. What are all the pieces that are kept there? What will be the nature of the functions, the festivals that the temple will offer, and so on. Okay, but essentially, puja and ritual is being passed off as blind faith today. And this comes from the British period, when they actually made everything that was Hindu into something that was derogatory, backward, etc. And all this was thrown out of the window as if it was all witchcraft and black magic and so on. But the fact is, in a puja, the tradition of puja, what you're actually doing is to harmonize the space. And the harmonizing of the space is done through what is known as yantra, mantra, and tantra. Yantra is a physical object. It could be a sculpture, it could be a painting, it could be a two-dimensional copper plate on which it's, the mandala has been engraved. Mantra is the chanting, the words that are used to evoke the energies of the environment, to seek their blessings and allow them to get into your home. Avahanam. Let them come into the space. And the person who is doing the puja, the pujari, it could be you and I, we have to empty ourselves to allow this energy to flow through us. So we become actually conduits. So the idea is to bring this energy into the space so that it may harmonize. And then, most critical, you have to send back the energy. You can't grab onto it. So ultimately, you say, please go back to where you belong and come to me when I need you. Okay? Next one. Is there one more? Yeah. So, the balancing of the doshas that is done with food, etc., also meant that you have a herbal garden in your home, invariably in the central courtyard, and the tulasi is a very important part of that. And the tulasi is also seen as Devi. So, doing your little namaskaram to tulasi, pouring the water of your puja to the plant, taking a few leaves and putting it into your rasam or your water is all part of the tradition. So today I think all this needs to be revisited and brought back into our lives so that we are looking at the environment, looking at the resources, looking at all that surrounds us, the space, the cosmology, the energies and so on. In what way can I participate in allowing them to come into the space and heal it? So I am just an instrument. It's when I start becoming very proud of who I am and what I know, that's when I have defeated the purpose completely, which happens to a lot of people. If you realize that you are part of a long stream of energy that is flowing through time and space, and every ancestor is offering to you a gift to be able to take it forward. It's like the baton, no? You take it and give it to the next person. It's got nothing to do with you. You cannot hold on to it, and it's not yours. You are actually custodians. The next one.
I'll give you some water, Shashi.
No, I've just taken. Yeah. The next one.
There's a question. There's a question in the chat. Mr. Krishna, yeah. You want to...
What's tantra?
Yeah.
What's yantra, mantra? Yeah, we'll go into it. Yeah. Let's just... I think this is the last slide anyway. Is it? Is there any more? I don't think so. I think this is the last slide. Yeah. So, I'll go back into that after describing to you in the everyday life of a person. There are objects or creations that have been placed for you and I to hold with veneration, with respect. Like these terracotta horses, they are considered to be symbols for fertility, for wellness, health, etc., etc. So, in a village, in a settlement, the people go on certain auspicious days and make small offerings there to say that I am aware of energies that are not visible to me, which are not in my control. May they create good benefits for me. And that ratha that you see on top, it is a kolam that has been made with a single line. And it is saying that I am creating something beautiful as an offering to you, but which is temporary. I finish it in a few hours. The ants have eaten it. It's gone. So in whatever I do, may I offer with the fullness of my mind, with the perfection that I'm capable of, even if it is totally ephemeral. May it go away. But when I offer it, let it be with a complete attention. Okay. And then, of course, the beautiful settlements with mud and thatch, where almost everything is carried out in the open. And you go in only when the climate is not okay and you want to sleep. That's about it. Everything else happens in the open. So this relationship of the enclosed space and the open space is very, very critical in Vastu Shastra. So going back to Yantra Mantra and Tantra, Yantra is the energized object. It could be a two-dimensional or a three-dimensional object. In Buddhism, it's called mandala. It's the same thing. So you have a geometric form, okay, which is engraved on copper, brass, silver, gold. Because these metals are supposed to be good conductors. So the energy can move into them. The three-dimensional version of this is the Meru, for which you have to have taken it from a guru and Sri Vidya, Upasaka, and so on. Mantra is the chanting. It could just be Omkara. It could be Gayatri, any mantra. Saying it many times with a certain kind of rhythm, proportion, with a certain kind of location of the notes is mantra. Tantra is a procedure. The process by which I'm doing it. So the puja ritual itself, the Shodasha Upachara itself is a tantra. Unfortunately, the word has been misunderstood as black magic. Tantra doesn't mean that. Tantra is just a methodology. And it also means allowing energy to move through you. Training yourself, opening yourself out so that the energies can enter you. That is a process or a methodology. Okay, let me stop with this and you can ask questions. My throat's also gone for a six. Actually, it's not a subject you can cover in 1 hour. I've tried.
I think each slide you can do 5 minutes.
Yeah, exactly.
Shall we go to the slide 2?
Sure.
The rational and the mystical mind.
Perfect, perfect. That got to you, right?
At this moment.
Yeah. That's where I started my journey, you know.
Yes.
Having to open myself out to my mystical side.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. What's your question, Amu?
There are 2 slides, no? So.
Yeah.
No, in the Western philosophy, I mean, we say, I mean, for truth, we want evidence all the time.
Exactly.
Yeah. Whereas for us, we say what is there is not the truth. I mean, it's not there, like, you know.
Yeah.
What the tangible is not the truth.
Yeah.
No, the intangible is the truth. How do we go from one to the other to kind of get to a balance?
This is an important question, Amu.
Yes.
Because here I think I'll go to what Krishnamurti used to say.
Mm.
It's one of his morning lectures, I remember. We were talking to him about a variety of things. And then we were talking about how do we give time to develop this other sensibility or whatever. So he said there are 2 minds. There is the ordinary mind, which has to find its way home. You've gone to watch a film, you have to walk back home. So it needs to have the directions. It needs to have a memory and so on. And he said, you have done this for 20 years and you have found your way home. Don't invest any more energy into that mind. There is another mind. Invest in that other mind, which is capable of becoming very subtle. Mm. So that's what I would say. I don't think it is a thing of going and searching for it outside.
Yeah.
I think we have these layers.
Mm.
We constantly only invest in this layer, which is acquisitive, which is looking after, you know, the security. Have I closed, locked my door? I know many people who will go and check it 3-4 times every night.
Mm.
It's something you have done and done and done. Enough. Don't use your energy anymore for it. Or planning a meal.
Mm.
You have planned your meal. You've cooked it for years and years and years and years. You need very little attention to be able to do it well. take that attention away from it and use it for looking at other things. Deepen your attention. Which means actually looking deeper into yourself and also deeper into the objects that you're relating to. Your senses are picking up the object. Like, for example, I'm talking to you. You're on the screen. And Amukta goes back 25 years for me. Right? Yeah. So there is another Amukta that I know. Rather than the person who's just asking a question.
Yeah.
Right? So can I actually hold that whole universe of reality with tremendous care and affection and invest in it? I believe some doors get opened by that.
Yeah.
I don't want to go too much into this because that will become also a theory.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, I was looking at the weightage that we give for each,
exactly.
At different times.
It is also because we are feeling safe in this, Amo. This world of measurable reality has become a safe haven. So it becomes routine, you feel comfortable, you feel protected. You don't want to come out of that and expose yourself to something different. So you stay in it, you stay in it, you stay in it, do the same things again and again and again. And that leads to a lot of anxiety, you see. Because it's after a while, it becomes monotonous. Like the Charlie Chaplin film, no? Modern times. It's like that. It becomes monotonous after a while. So there is a part of you which is saying, this is not what I was born for. What is the meaning of my life? Right?
There's some questions on chat, Shashi. You want to see?
Yeah, I'll just check it. How different? Let's start with if you follow the principles of Vastu Shastra. By and large, if you go to the older towns, they have followed the Vastu principles, not the principles that is being pushed on to you today by the market forces, which are saying if you don't have a higher southwest and a lower northeast, you will die. No. That is nonsense. That is being used to make money. Vastu Shastra in the old towns, like parts of Chidambaram, Kanchipuram, Kumbakonam, parts of Madurai, and in the north, if you go the parts of the old Varanasi, you will see very, very simple structures, quadrangles, which create lovely little open spaces, interactive spaces, which are rhythmic, you can replicate. Srirangam is a wonderful place for you to check. Definitely, it will have a very harmonious energetic pattern. Definitely, if everything was built as per the Vastu rules. There's another one, building Indian multi-storied buildings. Yes, some knowledge has been lost. There are many things which may not be possible now. I'm sure the Brihadeshwara temple may not be possible. But I have seen some extraordinary achievements by the Vishwakarma people. The skills are there. Opportunities are not there. They are not given tasks of that grandeur, of that scale anymore. They are just being used for, you know, restoring old temples and so on. Multi-storied buildings were definitely being built. There is a technology for it. If you go to the Sarfoji Mahal, you'll see that tall, up till 12 floors they've talked about. in the Vastu texts, and usually using only stone pillars and stone slabs. It is doable. But the span will be very little. You cannot have very big spans like we can do with concrete. Now we are able to do 35, 40 feet span without pillars. That would not be possible. You would have had to have pillars in the middle. But it's doable. Multi-story buildings are doable. But today, perhaps it would be very expensive because you'll be using stone and wood. May not be possible that way. Concrete works out cheaper. May not be economical. What would be the ideal structure for child education? What is Indology and history? What is the conflict? I don't understand. Why is there a conflict between Indology and history? Anyway, that seems to be a personal theory. I'm not sure of it. Ideal structure for an education center. See, the ideal thing for education would be where the inside and outside are very well blended. This classroom thing where kids are just put together inside a little room is a no-no traditionally. Most learning was in the open air. And they came into the room only when the weather was not okay. They sat under trees, they sat under the sand. It's very important for children to feel the outside. Today, it's being seen as a distraction. Even windows through which they can watch a bird or something is seen as a distraction on the child. So they quickly close the window or put the drape. So you're actually placing children into jail-like, atmosphere, which is a very tragic thing. Definitely a more interactive inside-outside would be recommended for any learning. Like I sit outside in Kotagiri, of course, is beautiful. The climate is fabulous, except when it is raining. I'm sitting outside under an umbrella and I'm watching the birds and working. And I tell you the level at which one can work when one is conscious of the natural systems is just remarkable. In fact, it is not at all, taking you away from your focus. It, in fact, increases your focus because all your senses get opened out. Books people want. Any that you would recommend? Books for children and adults. Actually, children, I don't know whether there are any books. For all of you, I think starting with Dharampal is very important. There are 5 books written by him. Please, if you can't get the books, most of his articles and information is available online. Please read it. Very, very important. He was deliberately kept out of the mainstream because Jawaharlal Nehru was against him. He was totally opposed to the English education and bringing in the European model and so on. So he was sidelined. Please read Dharampal.
There is a question from Nandini, ma'am. How would someone design a building without drawing plans and make models like modern civil engineers do?
They had plans. But they didn't make three-dimensional models. They only had plans and elevations. Apparently, they have had some model making in some rare instances, but they were able to build the entire thing with just plan and elevation. Even now, my friends, Ganapati Sapati's nephew, who's a good friend of mine, he builds temples with just the plan and the elevation. He doesn't make a model.
One more question, ma'am. And importantly, what would be an appropriate pedagogy for this? Something that can be abstract for children.
Abstract for children. At the moment, we are trying to make one, and we are hoping to have somebody who will use it. So if you people are interested, we can share it with you. We have created a syllabus for kids to learn, using their hands, the relationship between form and space. It's quite a nice sort of a syllabus that we have created for children between the age group of maybe 7 to 12 or whatever.
Emphasis for plots and buildings at the northeast direction. Which direction is the worst? If there is anything bad at all in any direction?
This direction business is a bit tricky. There is a whole school which believes that there are only certain directions that are good. But if you look at the traditional settlements, particularly the temple towns, on all four sides of the temple, there were homes. And all of them were designed, and the kitchens were never in the front. So if you entered from the south or the east, the kitchen was in the northwest or the northeast, and so on. Variations were accepted. Today, they've made it into a rule, saying if you look this way, if you look that way, it's bad and all that. There is no such thing as bad direction. All directions are okay. East is considered to be the direction of knowledge. North is considered to be the direction of health and wealth. West is for prosperity. And south is for rebirth and moksha. So spiritual direction. All four directions were accepted. Unfortunately, today they've got into this thing of south-facing buildings are bad for you, you will die. You can't just die by facing a direction. I wish you could. Not possible. You will die only when you're ready to die. So this kind of foolish fears. The south, there are actually locations in each direction which are considered to be better for the door. So you divide it into 9 parts, and then one part is considered to be superior to the next part and so on. But that also has 3-4 schools.
Another question. How is Vastu Shastra to be perceived in the modern context of climatological crisis, materials like concrete, and people who shun the knowledge of Vastu? Would you also please share a few reliable resources that we can refer to as architects?
This is the shortcut that immediately people want. They want to have immediate, instantaneous knowledge so that they have understood the subject. It's not possible. You have to go through the process of learning it. It took me 10 years to comprehend it. But today, in a nutshell, I'm able to teach people in a year or two. I don't think it's possible for you to understand the subject by reading a book. In fact, I would say don't read a book. It'll only confuse you. If you want to learn, let me know. I conduct courses. I will teach you. If there are 5-6 people, I'm willing to do a separate course for you, and so on. There is only one way, and that is to learn it in its slow ascension. You can't have instantaneous knowledge. It's not possible. Of course, read books. I'm not saying don't read the books, but don't assume that all knowledge is held in a book. This is not a theoretical subject at all. That is why Parampara Shiksha, I started by talking to you about it. This is a visual field. This is a three-dimensional field. This has relationship with your body. In fact, the traditional measurement is from your body. The angula is the size of your thumb. The jaan is the size of your arm, and so on.
Which would be oldest temples now still being used?
I don't think I have the data on that, but in Tamil Nadu, I know the Kanchipuram Kailasanatha is one of the oldest temples, and it is still being, the puja is still being done there. But probably if you go back in history, Srirangam and Chidambaram have been overlaid over time. So they probably are the most powerful of the temple systems. The Shaiva system of Chidambaram and the Vaishnava system of Srirangam.
When you say we should follow the morning Tulasi rituals, it sounds reasonable and feels like we should follow it. Yes. But when parents say it, it feels like we cannot connect. And maybe exactly. The reasoning mind is working there more like what's the use.
You're absolutely right. That is the reason why I walked, the famous statement of Dharampal. You have to walk backward to be able to walk forward on your own. Otherwise, endlessly you will be running behind the tail of the West. And you will be a second-hand citizen. I think that's very important for you to walk backward and study it. Backward doesn't mean backward in the sense of being foolish, but back into history, your own history, to be able to reveal some of the secrets that lie trapped in whole lot of rubbish. You have to bring them to light and be able to apply it and bring it back into your lives.
North Indian?
Say sitting on the floor, eating with your hands, walking bare feet in the garden. All these are very important. Yeah, what did you say? Kerala temples, 1:1, 1.6. Yeah, sleeping with your head on the north, yes. It has not been accepted even in the tradition. But it is also true that it's important for you to test out for yourself. None of these principles are written on stone. They will differ person to person. Like south facing, everybody, until I realized that it is also the direction of moksham, I used to wonder, because for me, south facing is the most important for me. I find that when I sit facing the south, I'm working at my best. So each of you has to check it out for yourself. The magnetic field in the north is correct. You can have disturbed sleep. Kerala temple architecture, the vastu is very similar, what we already talked about. But there is something called the concept called the Sri Koil, where there is a square garbhagriha in a circular precinct. And the location, the proportion, there also it's a rhythmic modular structure. There is no difference. But then the location, the size, the intervening spaces and all will be different, specific to that culture. That's a big subject. I don't think I want to get into that now. But there are differences, very subtle differences. But the idea of the sacred walk, where you go around, do the pradakshina, and then you come back and do your namaskaram in front of the Dhvajastambha. It's all very common in most of the temples. The idea is the Dhvajastambha actually stands for the chakras. So the sacred walk in a temple is you enter through the gopuram, which actually signifies your mouth. So you're entering through the mouth into your inner space. You walk into that space. You look at the Dhvajastambham, touch the base, which is supposed to be your Muladhara, and say to the divine there, may you awaken me to my potential. And then you go around and then you come finally to the Garbhagriha, and in that flickering light, you allow yourself to become absolutely silent within. Close your eyes and let that energy sink into you. And then you thank the Lord by going around yourself. It's known as Atma Pradakshinam, because within you is a fragment of the Lord. The Jivatma is supposed to be a fragment of the Paramatma. So you recognize that Paramatma, you go around. Then you come back and to the Dhvajastambham, you look at the top, which is the flagpole. And then that is supposed to be the Sahasrara chakra. So you look at it and say, may I rise to that state. And then you do your namaskaram and then you go out. This is the basic principle of the sacred walk, pradakshina in a temple. It's very, very important. Test it out the next time you go to a temple. Okay? So there are many layers. One layer is, of course, the market layer, where you talk to people, you meet friends. It's almost like a club. Everybody comes there, they gossip, this, that, and the other. Festivals are happening there. Weddings are going on. Ear piercing is going on. The hair removal is going on. All those are market realities. It will be in the outer. So that layer is just as critical. All activities in the presence of the Lord. So that I do everything with a certain rigor and a certain respect. And then you go around. See, there are three layers that you're supposed to do. One layer is the market layer. Just meeting people, getting together, watching the beautiful sculptures. That is the market layer. The second one is to sing, feel all your senses opening out. Chant, touch the stone, smell the smells, taste the water. That is the second one. You're feeding your senses. The third one is where you open yourself out to your chakras. Test it out. Do the three rounds. It's very powerful. I take people for temple walks just for this. Make them go through the three rounds. Okay. Any other questions? Please offer a workshop. Sure, sure. I'm offering all the time. So keep in touch with Amo. I will. Amo, why don't you create one workshop for the group?
Sure, we can do that. Yeah.
A 2-day offering. Mm. 4 hours a day. Don't have more than that because it's a very dense subject.
Yeah.
Mm. 9:30 to 1:30 or something like that.
About 2 days. Hours, yeah.
3 hours. 3 hours, 3 days. Mm. Perfect.
There's one question from Nandini. We want to take that.
Which one is that?
I'm interested in knowing how the architecture of spaces of daily life were planned.
Daily life. Does it mean houses in the home?
Nandini, you want to...
Nandini, does it mean in the home?
The home, the township, what we see when we look at Indian architecture is mainly temples. So what I'm trying to find out is how did the common people live? What did they use? Did they draw plans when they built their houses and shopping areas? Did they, or how did the person who became an architect become an architect? Did they go through a training period? What was their life like? If I'm going to tell this to children in the primary, I'd like to know about how the architect happened to come about.
See, like I told you, it's a parampara siksha, which means it is in the families. It was not like a public school. Usually, it is in the family members only. It seldom went out of the community. I was the first person outside the community to study it. So, it was held in the Vishwakarma community. Okay. And the training was for the boys only. I was also the first woman to study it. Now, of course, there are many women. So it was usually taught to the young boys, usually between the age group of 7 and 9. They also had their school education in the evenings along with the texts. So they learned to draw. They learned to dance. They learned Vedic chanting. They learned to paint, to sculpt. And there's a lot of metal work also. So it is it's like a craft community. There is a training. Till they are about 15, 16, they are trained. And after that, they are apprentices with a master with whom they work, which means sharpening the tools, carrying the small things for them, and maybe doing the first level of removal of the stone, where it's no refined kind of work. So it is a training. The training is done at various levels until the person is capable of handling the responsibility. So because it was a team, it was never an individual, you see. So there will be a person who is doing the client interface. There will be a person in the group who is looking after the accounts and so on. And then they were also encouraged to travel. So they would go as a group with the master Stapati taking them to various temples to show them intricate details, make them understand some structural elements and so on. So they did a lot of traveling also. Just as any other architectural tradition, they learned all the aspects. They also learned to work with their hands, you see, so they could build. They didn't give a drawing to a worker, which is what I do. They actually built with their hands. Yeah? But there's a lot more to it. See, that's why I'm saying to Amu, this is only the first layer that you're learning. We have to do a lot more. Note down your questions. And we'll see in what way we can address them. There's a lot of astrology in it, in the Vastu Shastra, which I haven't even touched upon today. Because that will take us off into something else. But let's do it so that we go through everything. Today's is only an aerial view. Anything else that people have asked? That's what the illiterate thing is very important. That's why I'm saying please read Dharampal. Because he talks about pre-British period, all that was already there and how many things were actually hijacked. And he also gives you the statistics of how many children were actually educated. And the percentage is much more than what we have now. And the so-called backward classes. How many children were actually going to school? The traditional school. It's very high. So please don't get fed with the lies that we have been given And all this was deliberately done so that we wouldn't use our traditional wisdom and go into some other system of education and practice that makes us actually very vulnerable and weak. It's not using our strength. Our strength is different. Like the whole idea of the Vedic maths, which is coming back into the mainstream, very simple ways in which you understood numbers that every child will enjoy learning. It's not a burden. So all this is important. And everything is actually enveloped in a philosophy so that you learned to be respectful of nature. Which work of Dharampal? All his books. There are 5 books. Go through them. They are not very big books. Go through all of them because he's talking about, there's one which is talking about the science and technology of 17th, 18th century. That's a very good book. It will tell you a lot about the craftspeople. It will tell you a lot about the educational system, about the local governance, the Panchayati Raj and so on. It tells you a lot. And he is not manufacturing the data. He sat in the British archives and wrote those books. So, are there any questions that we have? Harmonize the energies inside the human being while dwelling in a house. Yes, yes, we do a lot of harmonizing that, which I call Yantra Mantra Tantra, where we assist people to be able to realign the energies in their own home. Because I don't believe in this dependency on an outside person. I don't want you to become dependent on me. Sorry. That's not what I'm teaching all this for. It's not for Sashikala to become a great guru. No, that's not the bottom line. Bottom line is for you to be able to take charge of your space and empower it. You to understand your food. You to become sensitive to your bodies. And so on. So we do a lot of work with this in Ritambhara, which is what I come from. We teach people to actually take that step into becoming the owners of their reality. And it's very, very important. It can be done, and I believe it should be done. Like, for example, I'll tell you a small story. There are lots of beautiful stories that have come down to us. One is of Ganapati Stapati was telling me about the relationship between the fine arts. So he was saying that when they used to go traveling with the group, with the children and everything, the elders would point to the beautiful temples and compare them to the ragas. Relationship between the distance between the notes in a raga, which is the frequency of the note, and the distance between the elements in a temple were compared. And the overall shape, there are the shapes of temples which used to be like a, you know, the quaternary shape and the straight shape. The straight shapes were seen as the Shuddha Madhyamam. And the curvilinear shapes were seen as the Pratimadhyamam. So the, which means that Pratimadhyamam, the distance, you see, is not equal. And only then you can create this form. the distance between the elements has been played with. They're playing with it, right? So these are all very important. And you can't learn this in a day. You cannot learn it through reading a book. You have to touch, you have to feel, you have to watch, you have to allow it to embed within you. So this is a very beautiful analogy that was used. Okay. There are many stories like this. There's another story that, which also I forget, I noted it somewhere, I've lost it already. There is this video that was made by a European, a Frenchman or something like that, who got marooned in the Himalayas and he went to Tibet. The Tibetan monks took him up and healed him. He was badly wounded, etc. He stayed with them. And I think he also died there. He sent back to his country a small write-up and I think it was also a film which talked about how those people have used sound, shabda. They had the control over shabda. And they are supposed to have been able to move matter through a certain frequency of sound. He has taken photographs of it. How they have moved rocks from the bottom of the mountain to the top of the mountain, and it moves because of the, like they have these huge instruments, no, like a didgeridoo that they play, and they play it at in a certain distance in an arc, and apparently the object moves. So we are talking about an ability of a people who have understood material matter so profoundly, so subtly. These are siddhis, you see. Yoga Sutra talks about these siddhis. You are able to actually work with it for the betterment, not for making an atom bomb, but for the betterment of human life. And we come from that stock and we have become a very weak people, very defeated people. So I would say my commitment is to bring back this power of the Indian mind. If I can, wake it up.
Can I say something?
Yeah, please.
Your actually talk reminded me so much of the genius Srinivasa Ramanujan. His childhood, you know, like I happened to translate a story about his life as a child, how he was enamored by the ripples the water created when his mother was bathing him. And while he was walking to the school, he would look at the temple Gopuram, and the, you know, the elements kind of placed and all these
interplay,
things.
Yeah,
yeah, the patterns and the rhythm that you were talking about, I think that played a very important role in his mind as a child, you know, and that is the making of the genius, I feel, you know, the laya and the shruti, the rhythm that is there around in the world. It's beautiful. Absolutely. Thank you, ma'am, for this lovely lecture. And thank you, Amukta, for calling me. This is really good. Very nice.
We're here to learn and share.
Yeah, thank you.
Anything else, or do you want to wrap it up?
Any other questions?
I have given one.
Yes.
People record things because the greatest accusation in the Western world is Indian knowledge was never recorded. All we have is remains of temples. Anything on that?
Sorry? Recording. In the sense of what whether there are, you mean audio recording?
No, video written records, like the Western world. They have records of all that they did, their clothing, their paintings, whatever, from the last so many centuries. Whereas Indian architecture, literature, except for those palm leaf manuscripts, there's nothing that is recorded. You don't know about...
I think there is the recording, Nandini. Yeah. I think the problem is that it has not been taught to you.
That is what I'm asking.
It's been deliberately kept outside of your syllabus.
There is
recorded data. You have to now bring it back into the mainstream. Like I'm saying, Dharampal is a record.
That's about the last few centuries when the British came to India. They said they were the ones who recorded. But something about, say, 6th century or 8th century or 10th century are nothing.
Epigraphical records are there. We are not taught epigraphy.
What about the temples are also evidence, no?
Yeah. The epigraphy, the stuff that has been written on the walls of the temple tell enormously powerful stories. We don't know how to read it. We don't know the scripts. We have been denied entry into all that.
Palm leaf?
Yeah, palm leaf is before that, no? Yeah,
before.
But the temples have actually got records of everything on the walls. It's been written there.
Of the common man's life?
Yes, everything will be there. The village, the amount of food that was offered, everything will be written there. See, we have to go back into bringing back this data into the mainstream. It's not all written and put into a library where you have to just pull it out of a bookshelf. We are talking about 700 years of oppression, right?
Okay.
We are not talking about one day, 2 days, no.
Correct.
So if I have brought information into the mainstream, it is 35, 40 years of work. There are others who are doing it. It's not that it's not being done. We have to now collect the pieces. There are epigraphical, amazing epigraphical work that is being done. But several people I know. We have to now pull it all together. Make it come together into one story which can influence all our lives.
Yeah.
We have to work. This is what Dharampal told us, you see. You need one generation of dedicated Indians who can make this possible. So we have to work together to make it happen.
And it is to be in touch with history. I mean, the purpose of it is what, you know, to be in touch with our own history and our own...
Yeah, our ancestors.
Ancestors. And we have it with us, whether we are conscious or not. We have
it. Yeah. The languages hold it, Abu. Yeah. Our problem is when we moved away from our own languages into English, we lost the key.
Yeah.
Because the languages have a lot of historical data.
Mm.
The Indian languages.
Yeah.
We have lost touch with it. I think learning one other language is very important.
Mm.
Now we don't even know the mother tongue, leave alone another language.
Yeah.
No?
Yes.
Ma'am, can I have one more question?
Sure.
Yeah, I wonder how the Tirumala, because it's it's very high. I mean, it's on top of a hill. How did they make it happen? Because I can assume like about the Taj Mahal construction and all the temples on the ground level. Yeah, it's a lot of hard work. But how did they have made it possible?
They had actually a certain kind of lifting mechanisms, mechanical lifts they actually had, where you have weight and counterweight to lift things to a higher level.
To that,
those were already. No, it would have had steps. That would have been the first thing, you see. When you create something on top of a temple and on a hill, you would create certain steps through which you can carry. Weights. They would have created that. Otherwise, it would have been impossible. And then, of course, they used elephants. Don't forget that horses, elephants were used for temple building. Pulleys, weights, counterweights. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
And like I told you, it's a team effort. They had various levels of work, and we did not have slave labor. It's not like Egypt. The Vishwakarma were a free people. They actually had guilds. As far back as the Buddhist period, mention of the Vishwakarma as guilds, which means they were a free people. They moved from kingdom to kingdom for better job opportunities. So animals were used, and intelligent mechanical tools were used.
Okay, ma'am. So surprising to know all that.
Yeah. Somebody was asking about temples in difficult places. I don't think it is a question of deliberately putting them on difficult places. Here I need to explain to you that there is something called Siddha Bhumi. And Siddha Bhumi is land which has power. So, lands which have powers were chosen for settlements and specifically for the location of a temple. So, if the top of a mountain was considered to be energetic, powerful, and so on, that was used for building something. So that's important.
Or on the highest mountain nearby, you know, in the village. I go there.
Yeah, so that it is visually the most powerful symbol. Locations was not random and arbitrary. It was a community thing. The Stapati or the Vishwakarma did not choose the location. It was chosen by a Siddha, usually. Chosen by a spiritually enlightened person, the guru of that community.
Shall we? We're going to send the recording. But anybody wants any discussion on any of the slides? I mean, each was quite dense, I thought. So we need to reflect on each.
Yeah. Were all the gurus enlightened? I don't think that is something that we can actually speculate upon. There have been enlightened gurus who have guided the community, the tradition, and so on. I don't think it's something that is an important debate. Maybe there weren't many enlightened gurus. Now, by and large, they only chose the enlightened people to guide them. Like the Brihadeshwara temple was, the location was pointed out by the guru of Rajaraja.
But there were many people who were enlightened. I mean, can we say that? Who were not guru.
So they were called guru, ma. The enlightened people are usually called guru,
yeah,
or rishi or muni.
Rishi or muni. Because they did not become like our kind of gurus that we know now.
No. This has got nothing to do with it.
Yes. Yeah.
Guru means a person who can show the way.
Yeah.
That's what it really means. The person who can show the way.
Because at Buddha's time, there were supposed to be many, like, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Thereafter, there were many who were.
Yeah, yeah. Like in Rajaraja's time, Karuvur Thevan was supposed to have been a very enlightened man.
Mm-hmm.
And behind the temple, his samadhi is there in the Brihadeshwara temple complex. Karuvur Thevan. And inside, one of the paintings is where Karur Thevan and Raja Raja are having a conversation.
Because even in Orissa now, I mean, there are many, they point to people saying there's an enlightened person here.
Yeah.
He's just sitting there or, you know, being, living there, doing his daily thing. But he's not a, like a guru and with all those shenanigans around him.
No. Guru doesn't mean that.
Yeah.
Guru is a teacher who can point the way. Acharya is just a teacher. Guru is someone who can actually show you the way. Pathfinder is a guru.
Yeah. The proportions of the, you said there are standard proportions, you know.
Yeah.
But if you see historically, either different regions have different proportions, you know, or over the ages, there are different proportions used, you know, for different, say like in Orissa, some of the statues are, the torsos are in a way like shorter than the legs, you know, whereas in the, if you see in the south, they're more proportionate or, you know, the something to, I don't know.
It could be the local proportion of the people. That may be, they have adapted the local proportions. But there is a standard that the texts have talked about, which is more or less common to the entire country. The Ekatala to Dashatala is more or less common.
Yeah.
But so within that, having slender legs, defined waist, big breasts, and all that would be a local exaggeration or addition.
Yeah.
But by and large, they followed the proportions. Okay, shall we stop with this?
Yes. Thank you so much, Shashi. For
that was fun.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. It was really, really wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you,
Sashi. Thank you, Amu Akka. It was really delightful. Thanks.
Thank you.